Stand on your feet all over the place, if you will. Let me pray with you, just everyone standing. God, we honor you for this day. We thank you for the anointing of God we feel in this place, with your presence right now. Have your way. Speak to us and speak through your servant, but allow us, Lord, to enter into your presence and enter this worship, God, so that we may hear a rhema, life-giving word from you. Take complete control. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Stand up, if you will, for a moment. When I was a little boy, I grew up in the church, there's a hymn in your hymn book, hymn number 493. We were working on a sermon called This Means War. Look at somebody, tell them this means war. Do it again. Tell them, neighbor, everything I'm dealing with that the devil has tried to put on my life, I'm ready to do battle now. This means war. So when I grew up in the church, there are several songs we sang about battlefield and about war. And so let's enter into a little bit of war cry, a little battlefield time right now. So the first one that got me is hymn number 493. If you know it, you ought to be able to get it. Well, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Yes, I'm on. Promise him that I would serve him till I die. I'm on the battlefield. Come on. First stanza. I was alone and idle, and I was a sinner too. I heard the voice from heaven saying there is work to do. And I took my master's hand, and I joined the... I am on the battlefield. Point it away from me now. Come on. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. Yes, I'm on for my Lord. And I promise him that I okay, come on. Now that's how we did it that way. But then we used to always, there's another way to do it. There's another kind of song. And you know, we picked this up in the Pentecostal church and we would get happy. I'm a soldier in the... I'm a soldier. I'm a soldier. I'm a soldier. What did Job say? What did Job say? If a man should die, he will live again. Okay. I feel it now. Now, Bishop Kenneth Moles picked it up, and he created what he called a war cry. And some of y'all know war cry. The war cry is, oh! Now, let me see. We need to work on this. Can I get some help? Can we get a war cry up in here? Let me see. Somebody. Oh! Oh. Okay. All right. I'm going to hurry up. But then Charles Jenkins just came out with his song. And I just need y'all to help me just with a little bit of this. That's why I told the choir to stay this morning. Because I want you to look at somebody now. Just tell them, this means war. Come on, Debbie. Come on, right here. Come on, come on, come on. Put your hands together.
Joy in my soul, God is in control. I got Satan on my tail, but I'm singing all is well.
He's attacking every day,
but I'm watching while I pray. No matter the attack, I won't turn back.
Cause this means war. War.
Woo! This means.
This means war.
Yeah, this means.
This means war.
You know, devil, this means war. One more time, say, I got joy in my soul. God is in control. I got Satan on my trail, but I'm singing all is well. He's attacking every day, but I'm watching while I pray. No matter the attack, I won't turn back.
Cause this means war. This means war.
Yeah.
This means war.
One more time, you say.
This means war.
Hey, I plead the blood.
I plead the blood.
I plead the blood.
I plead the blood.
Over my family, I plead.
I plead the blood.
Over my church, I plead.
I plead the blood.
Over my life, I plead.
I plead the blood.
Why?
This means war. Put your hands together and bless God. Just bless the Lord. You may be seated if you can. I want to again lift up the book of Esther for a few minutes. I'm excited, as you can tell. I've declared war on the enemy. Amen. I can tell you now, I didn't start it, but I'm sure planning on being a part of finishing it. I want to lift up just a few verses from Esther chapter 7. Esther 7. So the king and Haman went to dine with Queen Esther, and on the second day, a banquet of wine, the king again said to Esther, "What is your petition, Queen Esther? It shall be granted to you, and what your request up to the half of the kingdom, it shall be done." And Queen Esther answered and said, "If I have found favor in your sight, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given to me at my petition, and my people at my request. For we have been sold, my people and I, to be destroyed, to be killed, and to be annihilated. Had we been sold as male and female slaves, I would have held my tongue, although the enemy could never compensate for the king's loss." So King Ahasuerus answered and said to Queen Esther, "Who is he, and where is he, who would dare presume in his heart to do such a thing?" And Esther said, "The adversary and the enemy is this wicked Haman." So Haman was terrified before the queen, the king and queen. This means war. You know, for those of you that have been studying this text, I'm sure you've already understood really closely. The Bible describes this situation as being nearly catastrophic, as the children of Israel are once again under attack and under the oppressive hand of someone who wants to take them out. They're in a position now where they're about to be killed, they're about to be annihilated. And the Bible teaches us that Esther, who has risen to the position of queen in the kingdom, is in a position where potentially she could help them. Potentially she could go before the king, and potentially she may be able to put forth her petition and bring out a change in the situation. But she has some fear and trepidation in her heart. She knows what happened to the last queen that went in unannounced or that would not go in. And she did not want to end up like Vashti. She decided that, look, I'm going to hold up. But she realized sooner or later, it came to her by the way of Mordecai, it came to her that, look, young lady, just because you don't know you're in a battle doesn't mean you're not in a battle. Just because you don't know this is a fight doesn't mean it's not a fight. Just because you don't realize you're being attacked doesn't mean you're not being attacked. Just because you haven't realized you've been robbed doesn't mean you haven't been robbed. Just because you haven't realized you've been hit doesn't mean you have not been hit. I was watching the other night a little bit of football, and the young man got hit so hard that when he got up, he thought he was ready to play, and he was lining up for the next play, and he didn't even realize that he was in the other team's backfield. He had been hit so hard, he'd been knocked out of his senses. And let me tell you something. You can be hit that hard in life where you can be knocked senseless and not even realize you've been hit. And some of us have been beat down and hit and been in a battle so long, the enemy has been working on us and fighting us and doing damage to us that we don't even realize we're in a battle anymore. We're actually punch drunk and don't even know it. Everybody around you sees you looking silly, see you walking the wrong direction. Everybody around you pointing at you, you're in the wrong place, come back over here. You don't even realize you're in the wrong place. You're so out of it right now. You're walking around in a daze, but you need to realize the enemy is not going to stop hitting you. He's not going to stop coming after you. So there's no sense in you playing nicey-nicey with him. You might as well take this battle to the enemy's camp and get back what he stole from you. Look here. The Bible declares that Esther realizes that she is a part of the battle. What Mordecai says to her is, look, see, I need to explain something to you. If you don't get involved, don't think that you will not be involved. If you don't do anything, don't think that, he said, the hope will come from the Jews from some other place, but as for you and your household, you will be wiped out. I need to help somebody right now. One of the problems we have in this world is thinking that because everything is okay with me, that it doesn't matter what's happening to somebody else. That my personal welfare is the only welfare that counts. That it doesn't count that little babies are washing ashore because people are running away from oppression. It doesn't count because people are pressed together in railroad stations because they're not of our faith. It doesn't count because maybe they're not African American or Hispanic. It doesn't count that they're dying trying to march 150 miles in the hot sun. It doesn't count because they don't look like me. But because it's not your battle doesn't mean it's not your battle. When the war happens, you need to realize that we're all under attack. Here it is. Esther gets word. You've got to do something. You've got to change the situation. And here's a few things I need to give you before I sit down this morning. I want to work with this because I'm excited about what this teaches us about how to do battle. Listen, the first thing you need to understand is that if you're going to be in battle, you have to have a courageous resolve. A courageous resolve. Let me tell you something. You know, cowardice will really get you killed. I've seen more people get hurt running away from a fight than in the fight itself. Cowardice, it'll get you killed. Look, a lot of things I can deal with. I can deal with a good whooping, but I really can't deal with a coward. This is a battle that's on, and can I be a little bit ebonic for a moment? Look at somebody now. Just say, neighbor, it's on and popping. It's on and popping. It's on. Listen to what the scripture says. Esther chapter 4, verse 15 and 16 says, then Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, go gather all the Jews who are present in Shushan and fast for me. Neither eat nor drink 3 days, night or day. My maids and I will fast likewise. And so I will go to the king, which is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. You've got to get a courageous resolve. Look, I'm in the middle of battle, and I'm going to be courageous about this thing. I'm getting ready to go handle my business. I've got to deal with it. Look here, I know some of you have been in battles all your life. Some of you have been in warfare. You've been in issues, and you're just so ready to give up everything, ready to quit stuff, ready to throw in the towel. I was watching a movie the other day called Coffee. This is not the old 70s version. This was about black coffee. And in the movie, the young lady, the lead actress in there, was in the middle of a divorce battle. And in the middle of her divorce battle, she was having a hard time. Her husband, who was a lawyer, and she was a lawyer, and her ex-husband was taking everything there was. And she was so tired, she just going to throw in the towel, just give up everything, just quit. And her new boyfriend looks at her and said, look, you can't do that on my behalf. Because if you do that, you'll regret it and regret me all the days of your life. There are certain things that you got to realize are worth fighting for. And every now and then, you've got to get in your mind that what you're dealing for, maybe it's your family, maybe it's your finances, maybe it's something going on in your life. You've got to find out, is this worth fighting for? And if it's worth fighting for, you've got to get courageous enough to get in the fight. You've got to get courageous enough to get, you know, and sometimes when you can't get courage, you got to at least get crazy. I think it was Richard Pryor said, I may not know karate, but I know crazy. Listen, you have to decide that I'm going to get in this thing. I'm in it to win it. I'm not going to quit. I'm not giving up. I'm ready to do battle. The enemy is not going to get the last say. The devil's not going to win this battle. I'm not going down without a fight. I'm going to be punching until I get through. It's going to be on. It's on and it's popping. And I ain't the only one going to get popped. It's on. You look at somebody now. Tell them it's on now. Woo! I'm not the only one going to get popped. It's on now. I'm about to do my thing. It's on now. You can excuse me if you want. Get mad at me if you want. But I feel courage welling up in somebody to take it to the enemy. You're not going to simply let go and let the devil say it's okay. I'm going to take your family. I'm going to take your children. I'm going to ruin your life. But instead, you're going to get to your feet and declare to that devil, it's on now. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. She gets a courageous resolve, And that invites me into the second part. Because see, when she gets her courage up, while she is doing her part, getting herself ready for battle, God is doing God's part. Don't ever believe that you can pray and God won't answer. You cannot. Bishop Bento was here a few weeks ago from Ghana, and Bishop Bento said it, and you have to excuse him for his use of all masculine language, but he put it this way: if there's a man to pray, there's a God to answer. And I want to Let me put it the way you can appreciate it. If there is a man or woman of God that's willing to pray, there's a God that's willing to answer. If you are going to pray, there's a God that is willing to answer. If you're going to pray. Oh, man, I tell you, Bishop Bento set me on fire. Listen, let me help you. Number two. She had to have confidence in the resource, in her resource. And what was her resource? Her resource was God. God was the source of her supply. I keep telling folk, quit worrying about the name on the check other than yours. Let me do that again. The only thing you care about is that your name is there and the amount you're going to get. I don't care what company's name is at the top. I don't care what CEO has to sign it, because you have to realize, I don't care if it's Electric Boat, General Dynamics, or whoever. They are just giving you what God has already given you. They are not the source of your supply. God is the source of your supply. God is the one that takes care of you. Look. If they go down, God will raise somebody else up to write another check in your name. Stop worrying about them. You worry about being connected to him. hear what the scripture says. They start off praying. They go to praying. They go to praying. Look at somebody and say, I know how to pray. I love that old story about that old lady. You know, they came to prayer meeting one time. They were in the middle of revival, and the revivalist told everybody in the old country church, he said, look, I want you to pray. I want everybody to pray, and I want you to read these scriptures every day during the revival. And the lady was illiterate, so she went to the preacher afterwards, and she said to him, she said, Reb, she said, I can't read them their scriptures, but I can sure pray them their prayers. I need to help somebody. You can pray them their prayers. There's some prayers for you to be praying. You need to get on your knees, talk to your God, and pray your prayer. You need to pray your prayer till heaven moves and earth begins to shake. You need to pray your prayers till angels are assigned and the Holy Ghost witness in the spirit realm. You need to pray your prayer. Here's what I tell you. She had confidence in the resource. I want you to know that there is an unseen mover always involved. In other words, God is already involved. There's an unseen mover involved. And while she is in the middle of praying and thinking about how her next step is going to be, chapter 6 says that the king goes to sleep. Now, you remember now, Haman has gotten upset because Mordecai, who is her uncle, won't bow down to him. He's mad because Mordecai won't do obeisance, won't wait. Oh, you so great, oh Haman. Shut up, you just a man. Listen. So he's mad. So now he's the object of anger that has brought the anger spread out to everyone in the kingdom connected to him. And because of that, everyone is now in jeopardy. But watch what happens. When the king goes to sleep and does night-night, God does wake-wake. No. You're not sleeping tonight. My son's in jeopardy. You're not sleeping tonight. My children are in jeopardy. You're not sleeping tonight. I got little boys and little girls you're about to kill. You're not sleeping tonight. There'll be no sleep in this house for you until I get your attention. Get up. I'm sorry, I'm going to shake you, I'm going to wake you, I'm going to mess with you. I don't care what your name is, king, whoever. You're going to wake up because the King of Kings is talking to you now. I point this out. You might think I make this stuff up. It would sound good if I had to make it up, but I didn't have to. Listen. Esther chapter 6, verse 1 through 3 says this. That night, the king could not sleep. So one was commanded to bring the book of the records of the Chronicles, and they were read before the king, and it was found written that Mordecai had told the Bethlehemite and the Tishah, two of the king's eunuchs, the doorkeepers who had sought to lay hands on King Ahasuerus. Then the king said, what honor or dignity has been bestowed on Mordecai for this? And the king's servants who attended him said, nothing has been done for him. Let me do this again. He's already been blessed. A plot to kill him has been thwarted because of what Mordecai did. He never even said thank you. But God said, I didn't care about him saying thank you then, because I was setting up for a big thank you now. Look at somebody now. Say, neighbor. Sometimes a makeup gift is better than the original. I'm about to preach up in here. I feel a little preaching that's coming. Hey! Yeah, you thought you slighted me then. You thought you forgot about me then. But what you're going to have to make up for slighting me then is going to be better than what you were going to do. You're going to throw me a few ducats over there. You're going to give me a shout out before. But now you're going to have to really show out and show me how you really should have been in the beginning. Now you're going to get me a robe. Now you're going to get me a donkey. Now you let me ride around town like I'm the big cheese in town. Now you tell everybody who I be. I'm working on something here. It is interesting that in the middle of a troublesome situation, that all of a sudden his mind becomes alert to an oversight. I want to tell you this. You may believe, some of you think, that all of a sudden that check just came through. You've been waiting for months and years, and all of a sudden it came through. You're waiting on the settlement, and it's been months and months and months, and all of a sudden it came through, and it was just in time. And you'd be like, man, I can't believe they held my money. I've been mad. I'm walking. And what you don't even know, that in the midst of it all, God said, nah, I'm just holding this for when you need it. I got this one. I got this one. Don't worry. Don't worry. The enemy thought he was stealing from you. Don't worry. Don't worry. The enemy thought he was going to take something from you. He thought he was stealing your joy. He thought he was taking your money. He thought he was messing with your household. But I'm going to make that rascal bless you. I'm going to make him put you up on high. I'm going to make him put a robe on your back. I'm going to make him elevate your name. I'm going to make him allow you to ride on his horse. I'm going to make him give you his ring. I'm going to bless you. He thought he was going to mess with you, but I'm getting ready to take from him and elevate you. See, I look at somebody, tap somebody real quick. Tell you, be confident in God. He's working behind the scenes. God is working behind the scenes. God is working behind the scenes. God is working behind the scene. God is working behind the scene. God is working behind the scene. God is working. Woo! If you don't mind, look at somebody. Just tell them, I don't know how he's going to work it out, but I know he's working it out for my good. He's working it out. 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 Just because you can't see the hand of God don't mean the hand's not working. I gotta press my claim. You, Haman's sitting there. He mad because Mordecai won't bow down to him. So guess what? The king calls Haman in. And Haman comes in all proud. You know, he's happy. He says to the king, what can I do for you? The king says, what would you do for someone that saved your life? How would you treat someone that was good for the kingdom? And so Haman thought for sure he was talking about honoring himself. So Haman said, I would give him my finest robe that I had worn. I would put him on my best steed that I had been on. I would give him a fine ring. I would treat him like royalty. And then what the king looked at him said, I like your idea. Now go out there and get Mordecai and you do that for him. Y'all miss that. Y'all miss that. Let me tell you something. Don't fool around and be my enemy, because he'll make my enemies my footstool. You thought I was going to bow down to you. Now help me up on my horse. I'm not bowing down. I'm getting ready to ride, Sally, ride. I'm getting ready to ride, Sally, ride. I'm getting ready to ride, Sally, ride. I'm getting ready to ride. Okay. All right. I got to get out of here. Y'all, woo! Oh, putting me down. Look at somebody now. Say, neighbor. Don't worry about people that put you down. Because God can raise you up above your enemies. Above your enemies. Above your enemies. Okay. I gotta quit. I gotta stop. I know I gotta stop. I done been up here too long already. I'm gonna take my seat after this last one. I'm telling you now, I'm gonna quit preaching, but it ain't because I'm done. I could holler right now. See, not only had she he need to be confident in the resource, but she had to keep her character reliance. Her character reliance. Look at somebody, say, neighbor. Character is who you are when nobody's looking. But you know what? When you know who you are, it doesn't matter whether you're in private or public, you know who you are. You know you somebody. You know what? She needed to go before the king. And what she does is, she doesn't send a servant to go and ask the king, may I come in? She doesn't send somebody ahead with a letter and a missive saying, this missive is being sent to you that I may have an audience with you. No. Look what the scripture says she did. Look what the scripture, I want to do this. I got to do this. Chapter 5 said, now it happened on the third day that Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court in the king's palace across from the king's house while the king sat on his throne in the royal house facing the entrance. She said, I'm just going to wait till he goes sit up on the throne and I'm going to put my robe on. And all I'm going to do, as fine as I am, how you like me now? Okay. Now, this is important you get this. She put her robe on. Now, I know most seductress in here would have thought you needed some other garments. She put her robe on. She put her finest on. Because what she wanted to remind him of is who she is. I am not only the queen of the people, but I'm your queen. And the queen is ready to talk to the king. Mama want to talk to Big Papa. I'm going somewhere. She put her royal robe on. She got ready. You know why she did that? Because she knew who she was. I think Adele said, because I'm royal. At some point, you need to know you're royal. The New Testament says we are peculiar people, that we're a royal priesthood. When you know you're royal, you act a little different than other folk act. But now, I see y'all ain't got it yet. Let me work with it. Because she's royal, she doesn't stand up there cussing and fussing. She stands in her regal garment waiting to address the king. And I thought I would tell you this. You need to understand there is a way to do battle when you know who you are in God. It's no cussing and fussing and yelling and screaming. You're not going to get me down in the courthouse yelling and telling everybody off. I'm not getting ready to go in this room and scream at you. No, I know who I am. I'm royalty in God, and I expect a royal audience. And if I can't get justice here, I'll get justice from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, because I know who I am in God. And if this is a battle that needs to be fought, I will take it to the high court of my God, because I'm royal. Let me help you. Let me help you. Look at somebody now. Say, neighbor, I know you're ready to fight. I know they did you wrong. But the battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. The battle is the Lord's. And because it's the Lord's battle, if you remember who you're connected to, because you're connected to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that connection will open up doors that no man can shut. That connection will open up doors that people will look at and will wonder how you got in that place. But what they don't know is who your Father is. You were born of the Spirit. You were born into a royal priesthood. You've got power that the world doesn't know about. There's an anointing resting on your life. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, I am a child of the King. I got power, 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 power. Greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. I got power, 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 power. This means war. I'm going to do battle, but I'm going to do my battle with dignity. I'm going to do my battle with honor. I'm going to do my battle like a child of the King, because I know in the end I'm going to win. I'm going to win. Look at somebody now. Say, neighbor, don't wait till the battle is over. Shout now. Shout now. 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 God is getting ready to do a miracle in your life if you just believe it. If you just believe it. I know we're in a battle, but look at somebody now. Tell them I'm in it to win it. I win. I win. I win. I win. Before you leave, I want you right now, all over this building, I want you to think of one battle you're in. Whether you're praying for your children, you're in a battle for their soul, battle for their minds, against the works of the enemy. Whether you're praying for your marriage, you're asking God to save your home, save your marriage. Maybe you're in a battle on your job, and the enemy's coming against you hard. He's trying to destroy you. I want you to get that battle in your mind. I want you to get it in your mind right now. Maybe the battle's in your finances. I want you to get that battle in your mind. And I want you to recognize that you've got to get the courage to do what you need to do, the confidence to hold on to God, and you've got to remain in your character while you deal with this battle. You got to remain a royal person connected to God while you deal with it. And you've got to know that God has your best always in mind. Always in mind. Always in mind. Always in mind. Come on, if you have that battle in your mind, I want you to give it to God right now. In the name of Jesus, I want you to turn it over to Him. Come on, all over this house, begin to pray. I release this thing to you, God. I turn this battle over to you. I turn this battle over to you. At some point, Esther has to go in and share what's going on in her life. At some point, you got to share it with God. God, I need to give this to you. I need to give it to you. I need you to take this from me. I can't fix it myself. I can't heal it myself. I can't make it work myself. But you have the power. You have the power. You have the power to make all things new. You can make all things new. You make all things new. You make all things new. You make all things new. And everything the enemy planned, I thank you for turning it around for my good. 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 Hallelujah. Father, we bless you. We thank you now in the name of Jesus for what you're doing in our lives. We rebuke the enemy right now that comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But we thank you because you came that we might have Zoe life and that life more abundantly. We ask even now, Lord, that as we turn over these problems, these issues to you, that you will allow us to confidently and boldly trust you. Lord, not to do it all, but that you'll do your part while we do our part. We're not asking you to do everything. Give us the strength and courage to do what we're supposed to do. But Lord, those things that only you can do, those whispers you can only give in the midnight hour, you do your part, God. Give us the courage to do ours, that we may see change in our lives. We thank you for it now. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, bless his name. Come on, bless his name. Everyone standing, if you're not already standing, everyone standing. I want to extend an invitation.